just at work today. So, good. That must mean we're all ready to get back to work and everything. And, yeah. Okay, so I believe we were right here that we did the nomenclature of carboxylic acids, common nomenclature of carboxylic acids, and then we stopped right before we were going to do the IUPAC nomenclature. So we talked about the carbamyl group, and I've mentioned that a few times and also in lab. So we've got this structure right here, and we're going to do a lot of the functional groups this semester that have the carbamyl group. So we've already done aldehydes and ketones, and we're taking a look at carboxylic acids, amides, and esters in this chapter. So we talked about how we would name our carboxylic acids with common nomenclature, and we took a look at this chart. And then we took a look at some more complicated nomenclature. And remember, with this one, we have the alpha carbon as the carbon next to the carbonyl carbon, which sounds like really strange because we usually want it on the carbonyl carbon, but no, that's how it goes. And then we talked about how on our chart we went through formic acid, which had one carbon, all the way to butyric acid that had four carbons, and then the chart didn't have whatever the common nomenclature was for carboxylic acid with five carbons, and we said, oh, well, there it is, and it's called valeric acid, and this one over here has six, one, two, three, four, five, six, and that's called caproic acid. And caproic acid was coming around in the last lecture we had, and that was the one that smelled like dirty socks or dirty goats or whatever that was that it smelled like if you were here. Questions on this stuff, friends? No? Okay. And then we talked about what happens if it's hanging off of a ring or if there are two carboxylic acid functional groups on a molecule, how we do that, and they said you do not need to memorize the common nomenclature for those dicarboxylic acids right there, so don't worry about that. And then we talked about alpha hydroxy acids and how we use those to treat wrinkles or acne sometimes. And why are they called alpha hydroxy? Well, on the alpha carbon, which is right there, again, the one next to the carbonyl carbon, you have a hydroxy or a hydroxyl group right there, which is OH. Okie dokie, smokies. Okay. And then we did some problems. And then I said, okay, let's stop there because if we go on to the next topic, it'll take me a little while. And that's where we ended up. And I thought I was going to record the lecture, the next lecture, and put it online for you guys, except for I had a flight delay there and back. So on Wednesday, we were sitting in the airport for six extra hours. So yeah, that really stunk. So I was really glad that we didn't leave on Thursday because the graduation was early Friday morning. So yeah, and then coming back, same delay. And I was like, you know what? The universe is just late. Just let it go. So I was like, okay. I bet you guys were like really devastated, right? You're like, darn, no video for me to watch. I'll just have to do it that day. But anyways, and you guys all did your quiz. Okay, I didn't get any complaints about like I couldn't see the pictures or it shut off on me or anything like that. So yay. Was the quiz okay for you? Okay, good, good. All right, so good week for everybody. And some of you had Professor McKean on Wednesday. So hopefully that went well and you got to smell your banana oil. Okay. All right, so for IUPAC nomenclature, folks, this is going to look pretty familiar because we're doing a lot of the same rules. So what we're going to do is replace the E on the alkane name with oic acid. So if we have an alkane that has three carbons, we would call that propane.
if we have a carboxylic acid that has three carbons, we change that from propane to propanoic acid. And what you'll notice here is number two says that the carbonyl carbon is carbon number one. So this is carbon number one in a U-pack, where in common nomenclature, the alpha carbon would be this carbon right here, which would correspond to carbon number two in a U-pack. Is that clear for us, folks? Okay. So you can see why IUPAC nomenclature makes a little bit more sense, and just because it's so much more standard. So over here, you can see that we have a five-carbon chain. That's our longest chain that includes the carboxylic acid functional group. And so that's going to be pentan, and then you will... Is there a question? So for pentane, you take off the E and you put the oic acid on the end. So we have a pentanoic acid. But there's also a branch of carbon number three here. So like we usually do, we have to number that for the location of it, and we have to name it, and we have to slap it on the front. So we have 3-methyl pentanoic acid. And this CO2H here, it doesn't mean that we have carbon, oxygen, oxygen, hydrogen. It's the short form of this right here, the CO2H. So that's one of those weird chemistry things that you just have to get to know right there. Does that make sense, folks? Let me circle it on the slide. So that right there corresponds to this right here. So that would be CO2H. Okay, friends? We're good with that? Questions for me? No? Okay. So number three says for multiple carboxyl groups, you want to retain the E in the alkane name and insert a Greek prefix like di, tri, or tetra. And between the E and oic acid, you've got that Greek prefix. So if we look at octane dioic acid right there, you can see that we've got the carboxylic acid functional groups on both sides. Okay, so we've got two, so we've got a dioic acid, and you can see that that appears right here in the end. So you see the dioic acid. And we have 8 carbons total, so that's the octane part of it. And you can see when you have more than one that the E comes back. So we don't have octanoic acid, we have octane dioic acid. Does that sound familiar? Like when the E comes back in? Okay, good. I know in the beginning of the semester we're like, why? But right now it should be sounding familiar that that happens. Okay, and the next one over, that shows another octane dioic acid, but it shows one that has some branches on it. So where would you put your branches? Same place as you usually do. You locate them and you stick them on the front right here. And we don't have 3-ethyl because the 3 comes first. We have 3-ethyl because what? The E comes before the M, okay? So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have a 3 and a 6, 7, 8. And if we went backwards, we'd have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So either way, we would have a branch on number 3 and a branch on number 6. Do you guys see that? Let me write in real quick in case you were thinking about your date on Friday night. Okay, so if we number the other way, we would still have a branch on 3 and a branch on 6, and we'd still have our carboxylic acid functional groups on carbons number 1 and number 8. So why did we decide to number left to right rather than right to left? All I hear is yeah. So you got an answer for me, just shout it out.
Carbonyl has to be number one.
Okay, carbon, those have to be number one, but it would be number one either way that we go, so that you would have the carbonyl carbons as 1 and 8 either way. So if we go left to right, folks, what we have is we have 3 ethyl and 6 methyl. And the M comes after the E in the alphabet. So IUPAC said if you have a situation like that where you could number the same either way, what you're going to choose is to number in the direction where you would give the lowest number possible to the one that comes first in the alphabet. So that's why we give the 3 to ethyl and the 6 to methyl, because IUPAC says you have to choose one. So let's make a rule for it. Does that sound familiar? Because we've done it before. Okay? All right. So when there's a little bit of ambiguity there as to which way we would number, because we'd have a 3-6 either way, you'll want to put the 3 with the E and the 6 with the N, because E comes before M and F. Okie dokie, smokies? Okay. All right. So moving on. When we have a carboxyl group bonded to a ring, the ring carbon is carbon number 1, which is weird because we usually want the carbonyl carbon to be carbon number 1. But if there's a ring there, the ring carbon that is bonded to the carbonyl carbon is now number 1 here. So this one right here, we're going to say that this is cyclohexane carboxylic acid, because we name it like we did with the other things where you name the cyclic structure and then you just throw carboxylic acid on the end. So we've done that with other things before. And then name the other things that are hanging off of that ring. Now right here you guys can see that we've got a hydroxy group at carbon number 4. Now this is not considered an alcohol for naming, where the alcohol gets the ending of OL, like methanol or ethanol, because the carboxylic acid has a higher priority than the alcohol functional group. So the carboxylic acid gets the ending, which says that it's a higher priority. And that means this is now a branch, like a methyl ethyl or a propyl. And we have to stick it up on the front. And when it's a branch, we don't name it alcohol or OL, we call it a hydroxy group. So it's on carbon number 4, so we have 4-hydroxycyclohexane carboxylic acid. Ah, you hope I don't put that one on the quiz, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now the trans portion of it is really interesting, because we're used to cis and trans when we're talking about double bonds, right, folks? Mm-hmm. Now the cis and trans, when you have a ring, so if you have a ring, we'll say like my hand is the cyclohexane ring, there's going to be substituents or branches that point down towards the bottom of the ring, and there's also going to be branches that point up. Now, if you have a ring where you have a couple of big groups, and that's anything that's not a hydrogen, and one of them is pointing up, so we'll have to tilt this out like this, so instead of up and down, it's at you and back. The hydroxy group is pointing out at you, and the carboxylic acid group is pointing back towards the board. Do we see that with the wedge and the dash? Are we okay with that, folks? Okay, so that is called trans because you have one of your branches going one way and the other branch going the other way, or if we tilted the ring like that, it would be up and down. Now, if both of them were pointing up or both of them were pointing out at you, that would be called cis. If they're on the same side of the ring, that would be cis. And if they're on opposite sides of the ring, it's called trans. Are we okay with that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay, good. Now the next one over, we've got a cyclopentene carboxylic acid, and you guys can see, a cyclopentene carboxylic acid. And you can see that because we have a ring, we're going to move carbon number 1 from the carbonyl carbon to the carbon that's connected to the carbonyl carbon. So that's more like common nomenclature, where the alpha was 1 over. And you're still going to want to have that double bond between the two as lowest, the two lowest numbers possible. So you would put it between carbons 1 and 2, and you would not put it between carbons 1 and 5. So you wouldn't go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 like that. You want it between consecutive carbons. And you can see here that we have one cycle of pentene, and we don't have to put 1, 2. So that should sound familiar from how we used to, or we still do, number double bonds, alkenes, and alkynes. You guys remember that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. So one cyclopentene carboxylic acid. And for the priorities of principal groups or parent groups, here's another little chart for you. It's a short version of one that we've seen before. And this shows you that the carboxylic acid has higher priority than the alcohol. And that is what we talked about right here. Okay. So why the carboxylic acid has the ending and the alcohol part of it becomes a branch and becomes the hydroxy group. We all right with that, friends? Questions for me? Concerns? Complaints? Okay. Moving right along. Let's do some naming. So, does anyone want to do the common name for the first one there? The common naming was way back when, right, friends? Like, who remembers that one? How many carbons are there in that structure, that first one? One. Okay. So if we were doing that IUPAC naming, it would be some kind of like meth something, right? Because there's one carbon. Yes, no, maybe so, friends? But when we're doing common nomenclature, if you have one carbon, it's some kind of form, like formic acid or formaldehyde. And right here you can see this. This is where we talked about it. Okay. So this group right here is called the formal group. And what's that little squiggly line, friends? Yeah, it just means there's something more over there. Okay. If it's a hydrogen, then that would be called formaldehyde. And if it's an OH, you call it formic acid because the ic acid portion of it means we've got a carboxylic acid. Okay, so what is that called again, folks? Yeah, that's called formic acid. And ants have formic acid in the venom of their whatever, their bite or whatever. So if you ever eat an ant, you might taste it and they'll be like, hmm, this is kind of spicy. Has anyone ever eaten an ant? I ate one accidentally one day and I was like, oh yes, that is spicy. All right, so the IUPAC nomenclature on this, folks. Anyone have a guess? Okay, someone said methanol. That's what I heard. Okay, that would be the alcohol. If you had one carbon, if you had CH3, OH, that would be methanol. If you have a carboxylic acid that just has one carbon, it's going to be some form of meth something. Yes, methanolic acid. Perfect. So we just follow the rules. And we would chop the E off of methane, which is CH4, and we put oic acid on the end, so we have methanoic acid. Does that work for us? Okay. All right, the next one over, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons there. So for common nomenclature, we said something with 5 carbons was called what? Valeric acid, yes. And then for common nomenclature, we started the alpha at carbon mesocarbonyl carbon. And then we have beta and gamma. So this one is gamma what? Gamma bromo valeric acid. And where on earth did we learn that? Well, we just talked about that back here on
valerate acid. And we talked about it right here, where we have beta-bromovalerate acid. So is that kind of ringing a bell, folks? I know that was like last week, but we did do it before. Okay, yep, and thank you to whoever shouted that one out. Yay, you. Okay, so we've got five carbons there. So whenever we have five carbons, there is what in the name? For a UCAP. Yeah, there's some kind of pent or pentan. So from pentane, we would do pentanoic acid, right, friends? Okay, so we've got something on carbon number four. So how do we name that? Yep, 4-bromopentanoic acid. Okay, are we getting this okay? Do we think we can do a little bit of that on Wednesday's quiz? Okay, good, good. I got a no right there. No, buzz down my quizzes. Okay, so the ones on the bottom, let's go ahead and do those with IUPAC nomenclature. So for common nomenclature, the first one for number two, that one is acetic acid. That's what we put in water and call what in our kitchen? Vinegar, yeah. You'll read on the label, it'll say a 5% solution of acetic acid. Now, with IUPAC nomenclature, if you have two carbons, there's going to be what in the name? Yes, ethane, some kind of ethane, right? So what we do for IUPAC is we chop the E off of ethane and we slap what on the end? Oic acid. Ethanoic acid is the same thing as acetic acid. Are we okay with that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Seeing as it's nap time? Right? Okay. Now the next one that would be quite a big molecule to do with common nomenclature. So we're just going to do IUPAC on that one. So we go ahead and we number backwards because our carboxylic acid functional group is over on the right-hand side and we have six carbons there. And whenever we have six carbons and we're doing IUPAC nomenclature, we're going to have what in the name? Some kind of hexane. So even for those of you who are feeling like I don't want to do another quiz on Wednesday, is that familiar to us that if you have six carbons, you're going to have a hexan in there somewhere? Okay. So the parent chain name for this one is going to be what, friends? Chop the E off the end of hexane and what? Hexanoic acid. Okay, I'm just kind of writing down my thought process here. So that's not the whole thing. Now, what do we have on carbons 3 and 4? Methyl groups. So remember, whenever we have the skeletal structure and you have a stick, you've got a CH3 on the end of it there. So what do we need to start the name with? So we have a tetra in there, but before the tetra, we need four numbers, and you guys just told me that we need 3, 3, 4, 4. Is this okay with us? Okay, 3, 3, 4, 4. Tell me what's next. Tetra what? Tetramethyl, and then stick hexanoic acid onto the methyl there. You guys all right with that? Okay. Anybody have any questions for me on this one? How did we get what we got? Was that an uh-huh? Or just the Okay, all right, moving on then. So we'll go ahead and draw 1, 2, 4 benzene tricarboxylic acid. So what structure will you draw first? Good, a benzene ring. You can see that there's benzene there. So if you were doing a written test, you would be like, I see something, so let me put benzene here and hope I get like 1 out of 4, right? Yeah, okay. So we're going to go ahead special, where the electrons in the double bond spin around a ring, so it can be drawn either way or with a little circle in the middle. Do you remember that? Okay, either way is fine. Now what we have to do is we have to pick a carbon number one. So maybe some of us will pick the top one, maybe some of us will pick the one on the right, and we'll just have to draw the carboxylic acid functional group on there somewhere, wherever we locate carbon number one. Any questions on that? Okay, now it says 1, 2, 4. So for another carboxylic acid functional group, you could go up or you could go down. Is that all right with us? Okay. Just pick a direction and go with it. So I will go this direction. And then we've got to skip one because that would be carbon number 3. And then go to carbon number 4 over here. How else can I draw these, folks? Yes, you could write CO2H off of it. And that would be 100% correct. So say you're like, I just don't want to draw it that whole thing out. You could put CO2H. What you'll also see sometimes, folks, is COOH. And that definitely looks to students like those oxygens are bonded to each other. But no, why? Organic chemistry. So that is the same thing. It's just a shorthand for this structure right here. So COOH, and that's the C, and these are the O and the O and the H there. All right, friends? Okay. Questions for me? No questions for me? All right, moving on. So structure and physical properties. So when we're looking at our carboxylic acid group right here, what we want to notice is very similar to our aldehydes and our ketones in that you have a trigonal planar geometry around that carbon, male carbon right there. So your bond angles tend to be about 120, 120, and 120, give or take. Is that familiar to us? Like at least trigonal planar and the 120 bond angles? Like, does that ring a bell from 2A somewhere? Okay. Now, the exact bond angles on there is gonna be determined by how big this group is here, and this group right here, and what the atom is over there. Is it a hydrogen? Is it a carbon? Is it an oxygen with some lone pair electrons that take up some extra room, or what? So that's what the variation in the bond angles is a little bit. So if you have a really large group, it's going to take up some more space, and it's going to constrict the bond angle on a different side. So don't worry about if it's 124 or exactly 120. Trigonal planar in about 120 all the way around. Okie dokie, smokies. You guys look like super excited about today. Okay, all right. So the other thing about this is that the carbonyl oxygen is named differently than the other oxygen. So that's the carbonyl oxygen up there. So this is the carbonyl group right here, carbonyl carbon, carbonyl oxygen. And this oxygen over here, when we're talking about carboxylic acids, that one right there is called the carboxylate oxygen. Okie-dokie, smokies? Kind of started, maybe? Okay, just to differentiate the two, what you're talking about, especially when you go out to dinner with your family and you need to talk about the carbonyl oxygen and the carboxyl oxygen, right? Yes, I would like a bacon burger and a carboxyl oxygen, please. Yeah, all the time. Okay, so what does this mean for, like, life in general? Well, that means that carboxylic acids are polar, and it means that they can do hydrogen bonding. And this is good for water solubility, okay? okay? And it means that carboxylic acids tend to have high boiling points because of the hydrogen bonding, because that's a relatively strong interaction, which keeps those molecules together. And if you're keeping your molecules pretty close, do you tend to be in liquid or gas phase? Liquid, because those molecules are closer. Does that make sense to us? Okay, and not only can they do hydrogen bonding once, but they can do it twice when you've got two carboxylic acids next to each other. Because remember, for a hydrogen bond, you have to have an electronegative atom on one molecule. And you have to have a hydrogen on another molecule, and not only do you have to have a hydrogen on another molecule, that hydrogen has to be bonded to an electronegative atom. Okay, because this electronegative atom is like, give me all of the electrons that we're sharing, that we're supposed to be sharing here, and the poor little hydrogen's like, all right, and so it's a little more positive than it usually would be. And that makes this electronegative atom over here quite attracted to it. So you get this nice little interaction right there, keeping those molecules close. And the closer they are, the more chance they're out of the gas phase and into like liquid or even way down in solid, but these are liquids usually. And not only do you have that, but you have a second one of those happening on the other side. So you get what's called a dimer. And then di means what?
Two.
There you go. So they got all kinds of hydrogen bonding going on here. So that means to get from the liquid phase to the gas phase, you've got to have a lot of energy to get these things apart, okay? And we have to cross the boiling point because that's where you go from liquid to gas, and you can see the boiling points down here. Where if we take a look at a bunch of molecules that are very similar, we can see that our carboxylic acid has quite a high boiling point. Again, the temperature where you're going from liquid to gas. Higher boiling point than these other molecules over here that are very similar, and that's because of the hydrogen bonding interaction going on. So you gotta put a lot of energy in there, which translates to a high temperature, to get those into the gas phase. I'm like, whee! So notice right here you've got isopropyl alcohol. So alcohols can do some hydrogen bonding too, like our acetic acid did, but they're not doing that dimer situation, and that translates into less energy that you have to put in to get this into the gas phase. Isopropyl alcohol is rubbing alcohol. So that's the stuff that is underneath the sink in your bathroom in some gross container that grandma put there in 1982, and it's just been there for decades, next to the hydrogen peroxide bottle, that brown thing. Everyone's got that, right? Oh yes, like how long has it been in there? Is it still good? Who knows, right? Okay, so acetone's over here, and then we have isobutylene over here, and notice isobutylene doesn't have any oxygen in it. So it's not even doing like a dipole-dipole bond right there. And it has a really low boiling point. So this thing boils at minus 6.9 degrees Celsius. That means it goes from liquid to gas at like a really, really cold temperature, which is interesting because as humans, we think of boiling as hot because we're always thinking of water boiling, right, friends?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so. Anyways, questions on that? Okay, so tend to be soluble in water, and they tend to be liquid at room temperature because of the whole hydrogen bonding thing. Okay, carboxylic acids are also weakly acidic. And at the end of Chem 2A, you would have done chapter 9, which was acids and bases. And we defined an acid as something that can give away a hydrogen, or an H+. Do you guys kind of sort of remember that? Okay, so carboxylic acids can do this. And the hydrogen that they like to give away is the hydrogen that's bonded to the oxygen. So hydrogens that are bonded to carbons are almost never given up. It's very hard to rip a hydrogen off of a carbon. They love each other so much. But the oxygen is like, okay, take it.
And if you can release an H plus, you're considered an acid. So you release the H plus right there, and it's gonna hop onto the water, and then this guy will become what's called the carboxylate anion, or the carboxylate ion. And that over there has an H, sorry, has a positive charge on it. Oh my goodness. Hydronium. That's my key to like find my coffee and taste it. And what that looks like is a water with an extra hydrogen on it. And because is not doing what it wants to do. So water likes to have two single bonds and two lone pairs. Now it has a charge, okay? It's just like, I'm doing something different. And you'll notice also there's a charge right here on the carboxylate ion. So we've got a minus one and a plus one on the right-hand side, which means there's a net charge of zero on the right-hand side. And there's also a net charge of zero over here on the left-hand side, so we can see that we've got conservation of charge. Now, remember that water looks like this. And if we take a hydrogen off of there, and we bond it to the oxygen. Sorry, if we take a hydrogen, did I say oxygen or hydrogen? Oh my goodness, I need more coffee. Okay. So if we take the hydrogen off the carboxylic acid and bond it to the water, it is what's called the hydronium. So can you guys see where everything's going here? Kind of, sort of, maybe. Okay. Now what's nice about the carboxylate anion is that it can do resonance. And resonance makes it stable. So when we have stability, molecules are more likely to do something. So because when we take this hydrogen off, the resulting anion is stable, it'll go ahead and do that. And why does it do that? Well, if we have this situation right here, this oxygen's happy because it has two bonding pairs and two lone pairs, which is what oxygen likes to do. And this one down here is kind of like, I have an octet, 2, 4, 6, 8, but I don't have my two bonding pairs and two lone pairs that I like. But it looks up to this one up there, and it's like, hey, why do I have to be in this like unsavory situation? Like, how about we share that? And it takes these electrons right here, and it flips them down so that it has two bonding pairs and two lone pairs. But that carbon right there is like, whoa, that's too many electrons around me. You up here, you have to release one of these and flip it up and make it into one of the lone pairs. So they kind of go back and forth like this, and they share that extra little bit of negative charge, and that makes that anion pretty stable. So, questions for me on that? Okay, now, because that's such a fun situation there, we actually have a naming system for the carboxylate anion. Aren't you guys excited about more naming rules? Whee! Okay, so conjugate bases of carboxylic acids are called carboxylate ions. So up here, we have the acid. And when we take the hydrogen off of the acid, it creates the conjugate base. You guys remember acid and conjugate base and base and conjugate acid, that whole thing? Way back in 2A, it would have been chapter 9 if you were on this campus in this book. Okay, anyways, so the carboxylate ions are more soluble than the carboxylic acids because they're ionic. So carboxylic acids are pretty soluble unless you have a big old long R chain, but the carboxylate ions have a negative charge. You can see that right there. And so the hydrogens on the waters, because the hydrogens on the waters have a partial positive charge, are like, whee, we're attracted to you because negative and positive attract. Now, if we have a carboxylic acid here and we have a base right here, the hydroxyl part of the base, sodium hydroxide, will come on in here and they'll be like, come here.
that oxygen right there
because it's attracted. Okay, so the positive of the sodium is attracted to the negative of the oxygen there, but sometimes we don't see that cation sitting there. Why? Because chemistry, and because sometimes we're just not interested in it. So if we kind of roll back over here, you'll see there's no cation there, but that's because we just put it in water. But anyways, sometimes you won't see the Na plus or the K plus there just because we're only interested in the anion. Another thing, friends, you guys are used to drawing the cation first, like NaCl, which is also Na plus Cl minus, right? We're used to cation and then anion. But in organic chemistry, we often draw the anion first because, like, a lot of times it's the big thing and it's more of interest to what we're doing, and the cation second. And also a lot of times we put the charges in, whereas like in 2A we told you write it like this and don't write it with charges. When you write it with charges, it's wrong, whatever. And then along come the organic chemists and they're like, ah, we're gonna write it backwards and with the charges. Isn't that great? Yes, so wonderful. So I'm just telling you that so when you see it, you won't be like, ah, what is that? It's just like, I don't know. It's just kind of another lingo there. Okay, so naming our carboxylic acids, and also, friends, this right here is like the salt. They put on everything and it makes everything taste better, but there's more than one salt. Like, there's not just sodium chloride. There's like potassium chloride or sodium bromide or potassium bromide. This right here is also a salt because you have a cation and an anion together like that in the compound. Are we okay with that? So when right here it says salt, don't freak out. Okay, we've got cation and anion. This is how we're gonna name them. Now, this is where it's nice. You name it like you usually do when you're naming a salt, in that you say the metal first, or you say the cation first. So, if we have this right here, you say sodium first because that's the cation. Just like with this one right here, you would say sodium chloride. You'd say cation, anion. Right, friends? Okay. So with our carboxylic acid salt, you go ahead and you say the cation first. So we've got sodium, and then you're going to say the acid name. And if I had H3C and then the rest of it, that would be acetic acid. Okay, we've seen that before. And if you rip the hydrogen off of it, what you're going to do is take the ic acid off of the end, and you're going to add 8. So it goes from acetic acid to acetate. Acetate is that guy right there. So instead of sodium chloride, you would say sodium acetate. Does that make sense, friends? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. So the next one over, you can see that it's got a cation and it's got a big ol' anion. Alright, so we're going to go ahead and we're going to name the metal first, the cation. So that would be potassium. And then benzoate comes from benzoic acid. So on that one, we would expect that we would chop off the ic acid and add 8. Is that what we do? Yeah. So if we're taking the hydrogen off, which you guys can see we did right there, we take the ic acid off and then we add 8 at the end. So we have potassium benzoate. Potassium benzoate, you will see on a Coke bottle or a Coke can, and it's used as a preservative. So it causes bacteria and mold and fungi to not grow, which is good because I don't think you want to open up a can of Coke and drink bacteria and mold, right, friends?
benzoate, those are preservatives. You have seen them before. You have probably put them in your body before. Are we okay with this? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay, lots of naming, right? Okay. So besides preservatives, why do we want to know anything about carboxylate anions? Well, that's because we love to use them in cleaning our bodies and cleaning other things and our salad dressing, because we love to eat salads, right, friends? Yes, we need way more than bacon burgers. All right, so if you take a carboxylic acid that has a really long arginine, whoa, like that, okay, and a carboxylic acid with a really long arginine is called a fatty acid. Did we kind of sort of remember that? Okay, carboxylic acid with a long arginine is a fatty acid. If you take one of those and you treat it with sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide, which is also called lye, has anyone heard of that?
Yeah.
If you use oven cleaner and you look on the label for the oven cleaner, it'll say lye or potassium hydroxide, because we all clean our ovens every weekend, right? I don't remember the last time I cleaned my oven. I should admit that, but anyways. But I do unclog drains because I have 3 children and one of them is a girl, and like all her hair goes down the drain and there's like these large rabbits out of the drain. And so, like, I have to put drain cleaner down there, and that's concentrated potassium hydroxide. So if you look at the label, it's going to say potassium hydroxide. So when you're unclogging your drain and you got your liquid plumber or your Drano, you should have your goggles and your gloves on because you're doing some chemistry, folks. But anyways, back to this. If you have a carboxylic acid and you use sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide, that's a base, and it will take the hydrogen off of it and give you the carboxylate anion, and then the cation from the sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide will come right here and sit next to it. And then you have a salt that looks like that, and then it's soluble in water because of this negative end, and it can solubilize grease and oil, and what usually sits in the grease and oil is like dirt and grime and stuff like that, and we get something called a soap. Yay! And the soaps, they do this thing called a micelle, where they stick their hydrophilic or water-loving ionic ends towards the outside, and their hydrophobic or their nonpolar or their hydrocarbon-loving ends towards the middle, and they form these little micelles around like grease or oil. And what happens is the water is attracted to the outside, and then it runs off your hand and it goes down the drain. So it cleans our hands and our bodies, and we also use this concept in our washing machines. So that's what our detergent is doing. We also use the same concept, except for it's not a soap, it's called an emulsifier, when we're making food, okay, like a salad dressing. So if you have a salad dressing that doesn't have an emulsifier in it, the oil and water layers will separate really fast. But if you have an emulsifier in it, which does this exact same thing, what it'll do is allow the oil droplets to be suspended in the water layer a little bit longer. So you're like, shake, 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 and then you take the top off and you get it on there so you don't have this big oil slick on there. Okay. So this is why it's important to life. Okay, these carboxylic acids and carboxylate ions. Because we like to wash ourselves and we like to have food, right? Good tasting food. Okay, questions from you folks? Okay, so sodium stearate, that is this big old molecule up here. And you guys can see the sodium portion of it, right? And the stearate portion, let me do in green there. The stearate portion is that anion right there. Okie dokie smokies. All right. So how do we make carboxylic acids? We have done this before. What we did was we took a primary alcohol and we treated it with some kind of oxidizing reagent that was not PCC. If it was PCC, it would stop at which functional group? The aldehyde. So something other than PCC, and usually our oxidizing reagents have a lot of which atom in them? Oxygen. So I had a list of the ones that we had gone over before. Let me get that out. Like potassium permanganate, which is the purple stuff that went to the brown. You guys remember that in lab? Okay. So we've got potassium permanganate. So that's KMnO4. And sodium dichromate we've seen before. So we have Na2. CR2O7, so you can see on that one, we definitely got a lot of oxygens. And whenever you have sodium, you can always do potassium. You can just switch those ones out. And those are our oxidizing agents. But they're going to take us from our primary alcohol to our carboxylic acid. All right. Problem there says, how would you prepare root butanoic acid using two different methods? So first of all, friends, butanoic acid, how many carbons do we have? Four. We have butane. So are you guys okay with that? Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4. Stop doing that. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I'll go ahead and put the fourth one right there. You guys could have drawn that the other way with the carbonyl carbon on the left-hand side. So we've got, that's the product. Let me draw that on the product side. Sorry, friends. How will we get there? And let's do two different methods. Okay. So maybe our first method, we're like, oh, up here we have, why did I do eraser? I'm not. Okay, so we have KMnO4. And what are we going to treat with potassium permanganate to make butanoic acid, friends? Well, first of all, is the number of carbons going to change at all? So we want something with four carbons, right? Does that at least make sense to us? Mm-hmm. Okay, so put that there. So 1, 2, 3, 4 carbons, and what am I going to connect to that fourth carbon? So just roll back right here. Wait, where did I go with that? Oh, I got two carbons. So, oh, it's on that same slide. Oh my goodness. What is wrong with me? We want a primary alcohol. So if I put the OH right there, is that a primary alcohol, folks? Yeah, that's a primary alcohol. That carbon on that we called number 4, which is actually carbon number 1, that one right there is connected to 2 hydrogens and 1 R group. So that is a primary carbon, right? And if you have an OH on a primary carbon, then you have what kind of alcohol? It's a primary. Yes, a primary alcohol. Yes, so this is a primary alcohol. Just like you guys see up here, how your carbon right here is connected to 1 R group, so that's a primary carbon, which makes that a primary alcohol. Do we kind of sort of remember that? Okay. And the primary alcohol is called what? Let's name it, even though the problem doesn't tell us the name. There's 4 carbons, so it's going to have what in the name of that alcohol? Yes, you're going to have butan, and it's an alcohol, so what's on the end? Yes, OL, butanol. This is butanol, the primary alcohol right there that we would treat with KMnO4, and that would give us butanoic acid. Are we kind of sort of okay with that, folks? Okay, so what's happening right here is we're getting oxidation,
And remember, the oxidation means we're increasing the number of carbon-oxygen linkages, right? So it goes from a carbon-oxygen single bond to a carbon-oxygen double bond, so we increased it to two linkages right there, and then we've got another one over here. So we have three carbon-oxygen linkages there, right, friends? Also, the other way that we could think of it is we're decreasing the number of carbon-hydrogen bonds. Right here we have how many carbon-hydrogen bonds? None! Okay, so are we getting reminded of these things? And can you guys see that we're starting to see things over and over again? Okay, just kind of sort it in a different form. All right, now this one sounds like it's a difficult problem, but it's not. Because if you look up there, which I have erased, I wrote three different oxidizing agents. So we can do it with KMNO4, or we could do it with what? Yes, potassium dichromate, or sodium dichromate, or chromic acid, or chromium trioxide, all of these things that we talked about before that were oxidizing agents, right, friends?
So those are the things that are preparing it, Ms. Sarah?
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's what you're doing. Questions for me? Concerns? Complaints? When's the next holiday? All right, let's talk about esters. So, esters were last week in lab, and you guys got to do banana oil and oil of wintergreen, and you guys got to make soaps, which was on the last slide, right? Okay, so esters, what does that look like? Well, we have taken a look at aldehydes and ketones and carboxylic acids, and now we're going to have OR on that side. So you guys can see that we're looking at a bunch of different carbonyl-containing compounds here. We're just changing what's on the right side over here. So instead of OH, we have OR. And again, that's a little prime symbol, and that's telling us that these two R's can be the same or they can be different. Now notice over here, you've got on that side two carbons. So it's some form of acetic, like acetic acid. Does that ring a bell? Okay, or acetone, or like something with two carbons, all right? Now you have the eight on the ending here, which is telling you it's an ester because this is common nomenclature, and then we're gonna do common nomenclature and IUPAC nomenclature because that's what we do, right, folks? We talk about it a little bit, and then we do common nomenclature, IUPAC nomenclature, talk about the structure and characteristics, and then at the end I torture you with reactions, right? Yes, that's what we do. Okay, and then notice the CH3 over here, and that appears here. So this looks like we've got it backwards. Acetate's here and the methyl's here, but that's how we do it. We name whatever the R prime is, whatever is over here hanging off of the carboxylate oxygen, and then we put a space here, and then we name this guy over here. So that one is methyl acetate. You're kind of sort of okay with that? All right. So if we were to name that using IUPAC rules, what we would call that, by the way, that's common, and IUPAC, you do the same thing with R prime group, so we would name that cymethyl right there. And then you have two carbons over on that side, so that's going to be some kind of eth or ethan, right? Okay, so that one is methyl ethanoate. So we're taking the E off and we're adding O.
oic. Whereas with the carboxylic acid, it would be oic acid. For the ester, it's oic. And make sure you've got your space right there. Okay? Does that make sense, friends? And don't worry, we'll do a lot more of this. All right. When you have your arguments connected, so notice we've got R on this side and our R prime on this side. When our R and our R prime are connected at the back because it's a ring, the first thing we do is freak out and feel like we don't know what to do with that, right? Yes. But then we go, okay, I can do this. I definitely can. There's an R over here, I've got a carbonyl group, and then I have OR over there, that's some kind of ester. It's a cyclic thing, and I am gonna freak out, but no, I'm not, because there it is on the slide. We call those lactones. Okay, friends? And it sounds like a ketone, but no, it's an ester. Those are called lactones. And we'll come back to lactones later. All right. But for now, where will you guys see this sort of thing? Esters?
Well, in lab, the banana oil.
So right here in this, that is your OR prime right there. So this is just drawn the backwards way. Okay. And what you guys did is you took isoamyl acetate and you reacted it with acetic acid. So that is the carboxylic acid that we put in water to make vinegar. And we use a little bit of H2SO4. So that is sulfuric acid. And we formed our banana oil over here, which is an ester. So again, we've got the OR written on this side, but that's not gonna freak you out, right, friends? Only a little bit, right? And that was your banana oil scent, but what the thing is with this situation is you guys can see that we have the double arrows here. So the reactants, they make a little bit of product and then they get lazy and they're like, eh, we don't want to do this anymore. So we're just going to sit here like this. So when you were smelling the banana oil, it would have gone back and forth between like banana oil and a little bit vinegary. And then banana oil and a little bit vinegary, because you had both of those components in the tube. Do you guys remember that?
Yeah.
Kind of, sort of, maybe. But the Monday morning lab, you don't remember that because you got cheated out of that because of clear four, right?
Mm-hmm.
Boo! Yeah, for those of you who don't know, like, clear four just said I wasn't allowed on campus that morning, so we all had to leave, which sucked. Anyways, okay, so that's where you guys have seen esters before. And also, oil of wintergreen, and that had a little less exciting smell than the banana oil. It was a little bit lighter, but it was still nice. And now, what I want you guys to take a look at on this slide is your methyl salicylate, which is your oil of wintergreen molecule. Notice how right here the OH is drawn down like that, and how on the slide above, it's drawn up like that. Does that matter? At all, folks? No, this is just like you flip it over like that. And it's just this person drew it a different way. Okay, so on this ring, you'd have carbon 1 and carbon 2. And on this ring, you have carbon 1 and carbon 2 there. Do you guys see that? Okay, it's the same thing, and our molecules, they flip around in our beaker or whatever. So don't freak out thinking like, oh my goodness, that's a different thing right there. Just breathe and take a look at it, and you'll see, ah, it's the same thing. Okie dokie, smokies? All right, now the nice thing about esters is they often smell really nice. So ethyl butanoate, that is something that we find in mangoes that gives it nice fruity smell. Pentyl butanoate, apricots, if you guys went into Chem 12A and 12B, there's an esters lab where you get to pick which scent you want to make. So do you want to make banana oil? Do you want to make like something that smells like peaches? Do you want to make this, that, or the other thing? And it's a really nice smelling lab. Okay? So anyways, esters are the good smelling ones. Whereas the carboxylic acids, those are the stinky ones, and then we're into amines, and those are stinky too. In the morning lab, I was telling them about cadaverine and putrescine. Yeah, kind of stinky things. Now, esters are physical properties. Take a look at the boiling point for esters. So, right here, you can see our esters are kind of in between regular old alkenes and then our alcohols. Now, that's because our alcohols are going to be doing hydrogen bonding, and we'll say that over here, like our esters aren't doing hydrogen bonding with each other, because what you'll notice is that they have some oxygen, so they have polarity, so they can do some dipole-dipole bonding. But notice how there's no hydrogens on the oxygens there, folks? And for hydrogen bonding, you need to have a hydrogen on an electronegative atom, like an oxygen. So with alcohols, you have that, so they can do hydrogen bonding. But with the esters, you can't. So that gives them a lower boiling point, because they don't stick together as strongly, so you can get them apart and get them into the gas phase with less energy input, so less heat, than you would with an alcohol. But because they do have the oxygens, and that gives them a little bit of polarity, they're doing the dipole-dipole interaction with each other, which keeps them together more than with a regular old alkene that does not have an electronegative atom. Questions on that? We're okay with that concept? More hydrogen bonding is going to give us a higher boiling point. Good with that, friends? Okay. So this is just showing you guys why, if you have hydrogen bonding, that you're getting the higher boiling point, because you can see again with our carboxylic acids how we're getting 2 points of hydrogen bonding, and that's keeping them together. Lots of heat input to get those apart. And so you can see a boiling point up there of 141 degrees Celsius. And over here we don't have any hydrogen bonding, so we have a boiling point of 58 degrees Celsius. Questions? No? Okay. So this slide right here is just like showing you in picture form what we just talked about. Okay, so then we have solubility. Kind of sort of same concept, folks. Our regular old alkene, there's no polarity here. And if you're trying to dissolve this in a polar substance like water, you're going to have some trouble, because like dissolves like polar things like other polar things or ionic things. They're not going to like something that's not polar, so you don't get a lot of this into your water. Okay? Now our esters, they have their oxygen, so they have a little bit of a dipole, because the oxygens are like coming out with the electrons, you get a little bit of partial negative and partial positive, so you see that you can get some of it into the water because of that dipole-dipole bonding. And if you have hydrogen bonding possibility, you can also get a lot of it into your water. Are we okay with that? We're all right with that? All right, so let's name our esters. Yay! Aren't you guys excited about this? Yay! Okay, so we want to identify our alkyl group that's attached to the carboxylate oxygen amine first. What on earth am I talking about? I'm talking about the R prime right there. And we already did this. You guys are good with this. We want to name that one first. So if your R prime is CH3, you would call that what? Methyl. If it's CH2, CH3, you would call that what? Ethyl. And you do that, and then you write a space, and then you go, oh, I don't know what to do with the next part. But yes, you do, because you have the slide in front of you, and we'll go through it. And then we're at magically number 3 here, because we've already done number 2, which is out of space, right? Okay. So number 3 says, then identify the carboxylic acid portion of the molecule and change that to it acid. Okay, and sorry, change the ick acid to 8 if you're doing common naming and not neighing. Sorry about the no M there. Okay? And you want to change it to 08 if you're doing IUPAC naming. So remember, this is our carboxylic acid. And if we have a carboxylic acid that is acetic acid, so I'll just go ahead and draw that right here. And we want to do this problem down here. You guys can see that we have an ethyl right there. And for common nomenclature, we go ahead and put ethyl space, and then acetic acid is going to turn into acetate because we take the ick acid off and we add 8. Okay, so we have acetate. Can you guys see that? Are you good with that? Now for IUPAC, what is acetic acid called?
Ethanoic acid.
Okay. So again, we're going to name the ethyl portion of it. Okay. So we've got it right here, ethyl space. And then what number 3 tells us to do is take the ick acid portion off of our carboxylic acid name and add OH. So we have ethanoic acid. We don't have FNOA. We just have FNOA. So there's not FNOOA. You guys see what I mean? It's just FNOA. Okay, we're at the end and you guys are like, please stop. Okay, all right. So we have ethyl space FNOA. So are we okay with common nomenclature and IUPAC nomenclature, kind of, sort of, maybe?
Yes, would you be able to just, like, circle, like, where they can come in?
Oh, okay, yes, so do it better. Gotcha. Okay. Well, I'll do it better, and then we'll quit there, okay? All right, let me do this over again. So if we have the ethyl portion that's our carbon, that's there and there. And then the acetate portion, is that a little better there, where things are going?
Thank you.
So for esters, we usually do common nomenclature and IUPAC nomenclature one after the other. And for esters, I just did it all on one slide because we've done it so much. Okay. Is that all right for us, friends? Okay, so I will see you folks either after lecture for the lab, or I'll see you on Wednesday. Does anyone have any general class questions for me? We are now pretty much on schedule. Even though we've missed quite a few classes, I actually built some extra time in. So yeah, if you notice on the lecture schedule, we're pretty on schedule. Okay. Any other questions, concerns, complaints?